The worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars. I hear the rolling thunder. Thy power throughout the
God bless, God bless. Good morning, good morning. Happy, blessed Resurrection Sunday. And so, again, another day that the Lord has made, but on this day, here in Clarksville, Tennessee, we, on March the 31st, are really celebrating one of the most important events for the Christian community, and, you know, could be for the whole world. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And that he gave his only begotten Son, if we just would just receive him, that gift of salvation, that gift of forgiveness, that gift of redemption, we would just receive that. we can all be blessed. We can all be blessed. And not just with his forgiveness of sins, his redemption, his propitiation of our sins, the atonement, God's righteousness. Not only can we be benefactors of that, but we could also be benefactors of the power by which he rose from the grave. And so that's the victory we have over death, over the grave, and which leads us into not only a victorious state, but also a state whereby we have life and have it more abundantly, where we are reconciled back to God, where we have the great, wonderful opportunity of being with him eternally, and getting beyond all that we have to face in this world. And so again, this is the day that the Lord has made. We can rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, what a blessing. What a blessing. And so this morning, on behalf of St. John AME Church from Springfield, Tennessee, where the pastor is the Reverend Dr. Vanessa Sweat, and the Impact Ministries, that being Evangelist Dana and myself, Minister Dantzler, we want to welcome you. We want to welcome you and just let you know that God loves you, and that this day is a great expression of the continued love, continued faith, continued hope that we have in the Lord. And so as we move forward, we continue in the Sunday school lesson from the series titled Examining Our Faith. And so we have gone through four lessons so far under that title. And so today, with lesson five, what we want to look at, the title, The Resurrection, Key to Faith. Key to Faith. And the lesson scripture is Mark 16. Focus scripture is Mark 16, verses 1 through 8. key verse reads like this. Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. And that's from Mark chapter 16, verse 6. And that focus scripture reads like this from the New Revised Standard Version. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of Jesus, the mother of James and Salome, bought spices so they might go and anoint him being Jesus. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is the place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them, and they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Amen. Now, from the King James Version, you find in verse 6 where it reads like this, "And he saith unto them, but be not affright, yet seek Jesus of Nazareth, which was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. Behold the place where they laid him." And so, you know, that verse is very, very important. It gives two sides. It gives two sides of a time lapse. It gives the was, and it gives the is. And so that's important to understand in terms of the key to faith, the key to our faith in God, the key to our faith in Jesus, the key to our faith in the story, the birth, the death, the resurrection of Jesus Christ is very key. Because at this point right here, we understand that the price was paid in full by Jesus' death. But we find that we have the receipt with an empty tomb. The empty tomb is paid in full, and now we can through Jesus Christ make our claim to not only being free of sin, but also being free of the wrath of sin, and we can make our claim to the victory that we have, the victory of that price being paid. For the wages of sin is death, and Jesus died once and for all. Okay, so we continue on. some of the key terms that we have to look at is reclusive, avoiding, which means avoiding the company of other people, solitary or lonely. And then there's meager. Meager means small and not enough for the purpose. Supposition means something we suppose, or a theory that's not proven. Detractors, people who deny or try to weaken your position. Then hallucination. Hallucination is like an illusion or something that's not real, but imagine. Okay, so those are some of the key terms as the commentary notes. Before we get into the introduction, I always like to think about what other outlines might give us, you know. And so from the encouraging word, what we find is, again, looking at Mark 16 and verses 1 through 6, they have it noted here, the women discover an empty tomb and a special messenger. Okay, so now when the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome bought spices that they might come and anoint him. Very early in the morning, on the first day of the week, they came to the tomb when the sun had risen, and they said among themselves, "Who will roll away the stone from the door of the tomb for us?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone had been rolled away, for it was very large. And entering the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a long white robe sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen. He is not here. See the place where they laid him." So the thing here is, when the Sabbath was passed, there means that the earliest that the women could go to the tomb and properly embalm the body of Jesus was on Sunday morning. Sabbath was over at the start of Saturday evening. And so, you know, there's a lot of talk about the 3 days, when we say 3 days, and what 3 days mean to us now is not the same as back then in that culture. And so we got to kind of keep that in mind. But it wasn't light enough until Sunday morning to do the work. So the time from Sunday on Friday to sunrise on Sunday must have been dark. Okay. Empty and desperate days for the disciples. You know, you have to imagine that this is the one who they have decided, and as was noted in the scriptures, they gave up everything to follow Jesus. And so they may have had their different ideas or thoughts or opinions about who Jesus was, but the true disciples had given up much to actually follow him. And so Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James and Salome, these women proved themselves to be the most devoted followers of Jesus, and they were the first to proclaim his resurrection. Okay. They brought the spices, which were not used for mummification. It wasn't about mummification. So they didn't practice that as with the Egyptians, but which was not, that wasn't a Jewish custom. so it wasn't a part of it. But to offset the odor from decomposition. So we should understand that they didn't have all the things, the chemicals and things that we have for the dead, for bodies. Okay. So the question of who will roll away the stone from the door of the tomb for us, the women were not expecting to find the empty tomb. They weren't expecting that. They were expecting to find a body of which they would apply those spices. They came wondering how the stone to the door was going to be moved so that they can get in through the opening of what would be a hewn carving or cave into perhaps a mountain side, and the door would just be a small, maybe 3 feet door that you could get into, maybe 3 feet high, maybe 3 or 4 feet high, maybe 2 or 3 feet wide, so that they can get in. So that's what their expectation was, to go in and see the body and take care of that. This shows that the resurrection accounts cannot be the product of wishful thinking. The disciples of Jesus did not expect it to happen. They just did not, even though Jesus had mentioned to them about him being raised from the dead. Because Matthew 27:65-66 reminds us that there was a guard set round the tomb. He was set round the tomb. All this shows that the stone could not have been rolled away by the women. They were not strong enough. They weren't strong enough. Or by the disciples, even if they were brave enough, they could not overcome the guards, the armed guards. And so we understand that no one else wanted to roll the stone away. Matthew 28:2 tells us that it was an angel who rolled the stone away. Okay, the stone was not rolled away to let Jesus out. John 20:19 tells us that Jesus in his resurrection body could pass through material barriers. It was rolled away so that others, right, could see into the tomb and be persuaded that Jesus Christ was risen from the dead. And that's why the angel says, see for yourself, letting the ladies know, you know, these ladies would be prominent witnesses. They would be witnesses. They needed to see for themselves. And so the angel facilitated them being eyewitnesses, not ear witnesses, but eyewitnesses of that situation. And so what they would find is the young man, a young man in clothes, in a long white robe sitting. The women saw an angel in a human form who told them of the resurrected Jesus and showed them the empty tomb. He showed them who was crucified, and he is risen now. And so this, at this point, I just want to just kind of highlight that this is a crucial point right here, which gives a verification, or it lets us know that, in fact, and this is what the angel is letting us know, in fact, he was crucified. In fact, because of the naysayers or detractors, as it was put, the detractors would say he wasn't crucified, or that he may have suffered all of the trimmings of a crucifixion, but in fact that he did not die. And so we'll talk about that a little bit as we go along. And he was crucified beyond all doubt. And that means that he was dead. That means that he was dead. But now, so the angel goes on to say he is risen. So not only resuscitated. It's not like he's resuscitated, but he's resurrected. He is resurrected. And so there are several examples in the Bible of people being resuscitated before this, such as the widow's son in the days of Elijah, from 1 Kings 17. 17 through 24, and Lazarus from the book of John, chapter 11, 38 through 44. So you have each of these was resuscitated from death, and that means that they was going to die again. They did not receive a glorified body, and they were going to die again. And so, but none of them were resurrected. Resurrected would have meant that there would be, as what with Jesus Christ, a change in the body, there's much to be understood about that, but it was a totally different experience. So each of them was raised in the same body that they died in and raised from the dead to eventually die again. So we try to understand that resurrection isn't just living again. It is living again in a new body based on our old body, perfectly suited for life in eternity. And that's key with resurrection, that it ties into eternity being versus being resuscitated. Okay, so Jesus was not the first one brought back from the dead, but he was the first one resurrected. Amen. And so we should also say that Jesus still is risen. And so that's key to understand, because through the scriptures we find that Jesus is had ascended and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He ascended into heaven and continues to reign as a resurrected man, still fully man and fully God. Amen. Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified, in fact, and we have the official announcement even when Joseph of Arimathea went and requested the body of Jesus from Pilate, and Pilate questioned, because crucifixion wasn't meant to be a quick thing. It wasn't meant to be a quick thing. Crucifixion was supposed to be a drawn out, excruciating, humiliating experience. But when he questioned, when Joseph of Arimathea questioned Pilate about the getting the body, Pilate was like, "Is he dead already?" And he sent someone to check it out, and so. The experts of crucifixion, they knew when a person was dead. They had to be, they had to know at what point, this person died. And so they gave the word to Pilate that in fact he was dead. And so that's the one thing. So again, throughout this whole time, while the scriptures don't let us know exactly what happened in the resurrecting experience with Jesus, does let us know that he in fact died. He in fact was crucified. He died. And then on the flip, on the other side of that, it lets us know that he in fact was risen or had raised up from the dead, came back to life. not resuscitated, but resurrected. Amen. Amen. So that's just some of the stuff that we can look at before we go. Again, the it says that that let me go back and look at something here. Nazareth, Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified, and these were not exalted titles for Jesus, by the way. We should note that Jesus, the name Jesus, and wasn't a special name. Other people were named Jesus. So it's part of the humility of the Lord Jesus. It's part of his humility. In fact, you know, where he was born, you know, being in a manger, how he came, you know. I mean, we're talking about the Savior of the world. We're talking about Jesus the Christ. We're talking about the Son of God. You know, but the way he came, you know, the way he came with the whole manger scene, the whole baby scene and everything with that. And then even with the name Jesus, Jesus was a common name. And with Jesus, how he lived and how a lot of the experiences, because he experienced things that were common to people, to human beings, you know. And so he can identify. He could identify with us all. And so when we think about that, Nazareth was not a place to be proud of. And crucified was a title of shame. You know, that was a title of shame, not to be honored. Again, it was in a humiliating situation where you were displayed before all the people to see. Yet Jesus was not ashamed to be called of Nazareth and crucified. All of these things brought some sense of the identity to which he took on of us. This description of shame has become his crown of glory. So we should understand that. For Paul and all who look to the crucified and risen Christ and as Savior and Lord, that's the gist of it. And it's foolishness to the world. It's foolishness to them who are still in sin, who are still blinded by sin. It's foolishness to them who are of the world. But the angel goes on to say, see the place where they laid him. And so the actual event of Jesus, you know, like I said, we don't get that, but the women get an eye view of an empty tomb, of an empty tomb. They, you know, hey, they saw it for themselves. You know, here, the women who intended to give Jesus' body a more proper preparation for burial, they discover that the stone was rolled away and the body is not in the tomb. And so, though, you know, with those two things, we understand that things really got to going by that time. And so I want to go ahead and continue on into the introduction from our commentary now. So we see that, you know, from different sources, what is really going on here. Now, as our main source for the Sunday school lesson, the introduction talks about believers, talks about us as believers. You know, the one thing is it uses to help us better understand is is the issues of life. And when I say the issues of life, I'm talking about the risk and uncertainty of living out life. And one of the people they share with us is Howard Hughes, who was very rich. He was the one, at one point, he was the richest man in the world. And he had so much, you know, influence, wealth and influence. But he could not, you know, as much as a recluse he was, he could not escape the risk and the uncertainty of life, you know. And so as an introduction, we understand that with ordinary people, now we're not talking about the filthy rich like Basil or Elon Musk. We're not talking about people like that. We're not talking about people who are billionaires. We're not talking about Beyonce and Jay-Z. We're not talking about them. We're not talking about Taylor Swift. We're not talking about people who are filthy, filthy rich, right? But we're talking about ordinary people now. Now, ordinary people with meager resources. Meager, remember, meager, small and not enough for the purpose, for the purpose of living. Ordinary people who don't have a whole lot of resources. We got to get out here and work. We got to make sure, like people say, we get on the grind, right? To make sure that we can take care of things, take care of our needs and such. We cannot hope to take the uncertainty out of living at all. And so there's this question about how believers facing uncertainty and the ordinary risk of life should do so. How can we do it? How can we face uncertainty and ordinary risk of life? How are we going to do that? And then another question as an introductory, do believers and non-believers employ the same strategies to deal with uncertainties of living? Do we employ the same strategies? A lot of people talk about how to live, how to manage life, how to manage time, how to deal with issues on the job, social issues amongst family, friends, even strangers. And so the strategies for living and being an asset to the community. How can we do that? Do we use the same strategies? Is the question. And so another question is, does our faith give us an advantage in facing the blind corners of life? Does our faith in the Lord, does the faith of Jesus Christ, being the Son of God, who died for us and who is now risen again, does that give us an advantage over others who are non-believers, who don't have that faith? I was kind of, you know, thinking to title this introduction, The Blind Corners of Life, because that's what we have to deal with. And now, as we go into telling the story, telling the Bible story, in some respects, what was happening with Jesus' body after his crucifixion was unusual. That was unusual. Crucifixion was a common thing. But some of the things, like him dying at the time, you know, the Sabbath was at an end, and then, you know, there's the thing about his bones not being broken, right? The water and blood pouring from his side, and so it's these kinds of things, these kinds of tidbits that we find was unusual. Okay. Normally, the anointing of the body with the spices and whatnot would have taken place before the burial, and so that's why the the issue about, or the question about, who's going to roll the stone away. That's why that comes up, right? However, in Jesus' case, the Sabbath began before Jesus' disciple could even care for his body. And so, even place it in the tomb. And so you see Mark 15:42, Deuteronomy 21:23, and Matthew 27:59-60. This basically sets up the early morning visit with the ladies. That's how that goes right there. Let me see if I can pull up something here to help us understand these scriptures that I just read. Mark 15. Okay, let's see here. Okay, so 42. That Mark 15:42 reads, and now when the even was come, right, because it was the preparation, that is the day before the Sabbath, right? So it was basically saying, let me go back. There were also women looking on afar off, among whom was Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, the less, and of Joses and Salome. Okay. Who also, when he was in Galilee, followed him and ministered unto him, and many other women which came up with him unto Jerusalem. And now when even was come, because it was the preparation, that is the day before the Sabbath. Okay, so Joseph of Arimathea, an honorable counselor, which also waited for the kingdom of God, came and went in boldly unto Pilate, and craved the body of Jesus. And Pilate, again, he marveled if he were already dead, and calling unto him the centurion, he asked, is the expert that of the crucifixion? He carried out these things, so he would have known, right? He asked him whether he had been any while dead, and when he knew it of the centurion, got the official word that he was dead, he gave the body to Joseph. And so that's what that all is about right there. Deuteronomy 21:23 reads, let's see here, let's look at that. That's going to take us back to the Old Testament, Deuteronomy 21:23. Let's see here. We'll see. 23. Okay, it reads, I'm going to start at 22, and if a man have committed a sin worthy of death, and he be to be put to death, and thou hang him on a tree, verse 23 says, his body shall not remain all night upon the tree, but thou shalt in any wise bury him that day, for he that is hanged is accursed of God, that thy land be not defiled, which the Lord thy God giveth thee for an inheritance. And so we understand how these scriptures play out. Amen. Let's take a look at Matthew 27:59 through, let's see. Now we're going back to the New Testament. And Matthew's, 27. We got to go all the way to 59:60. Let's see here. Let's go all the way. 59:60. Okay, now 57 starts with the burial. When the evening was come, there came a rich man of Arimathea. So this talks about Joseph, who Joseph, who also himself was Jesus' disciple, he went to Pilate and begged the body of Jesus. And so that just kind of covers that same situation. But it gives a little bit more detail because it says that, and when Joseph had taken the body, he wrapped it in a clean linen cloth. So this is where we get the linen cloth in the tomb and everything, which he had hewn out in the rock. So that tomb was hewn out. That was his tomb, right? And it, those tombs would cost a lot. It would cost a lot of money for that to have happened. So he paid a lot. And then it says, and he rolled a great stone to the door of the sepulcher and departed. So it actually says that Joseph of Arimathea, he did, again, another eyewitness to the fact that Jesus' body was put in there and the stone was rolled over. And then after that, the guards were put in place. Of course, there was an accusation that some of the disciples would steal the body by night. They would come in and steal the body. And so guards was put there to ensure that the body of Jesus was not taken and that any alleged resurrection would be pronounced or announced based on a fraud or a scheme of such. But the rock, the stone, a huge stone was put in place, a great stone, as it's noted, to the door of something. And there was Mary Magdalene and the other Mary sitting over against the sepulchre. And so they again witnessed the stone being rolled in place, being put in place. Okay, so now we have more questions that we could ask. Okay, so the question that the three women asked at 16 and 3 talks about women, highlights quality that should be part of the lives of believers. First, they were, you know, determined to do what they had felt they need to do based on their relationship with Jesus, right? And then also they were so focused on what they felt their duty was that they had really not thought about the stone being in place like that. They really didn't think about it, how they was going to be able to prepare his body if the stone was in place, because they didn't have the strength to do it. And then also they knew that they had a job to do, and so they set out to do it. Commentary says this may have been a measure of faith. And so one of the things that I thought about is that the fact is that as with Mary and Martha and Lazarus, that their faith, the extent of their faith went to was up to healing. And so that's why they said, you know, Lord, if you had been there, then, you know, our brother Lazarus wouldn't have died. And Jesus let them know that, you know, he is the resurrection, because they had knowledge about the resurrection, but that in the resurrection that they would live again. But they didn't think about the fact that Jesus is the resurrection. And so the power that Jesus had was beyond just a healing. It was beyond just a healing. And our faith, you know, for them and perhaps for us, our faith only goes as far as to a certain place. For them, it was to healing. And so the same thing with them, their faith, their expression or extent of faith only got to their duties with Jesus while Jesus lived. And so, you know, you have to think that our faith in Jesus is got to go beyond, like the Apostle Paul said, for me to live is Christ, but for me to die is gain. Why? Because I serve a living hope. I have a living hope. I have a living hope. Jesus is not a dead hope. He's a living hope. Perhaps some of these other people who are celebrated, they are dead hopes because they died, and their death ends right there. The power of their influence or whatever, it ends with their death. But with Jesus, not so. With Jesus, not so. And so that's what we find there. Okay. So, and also, you know, the women were adamant and focused, and they didn't, you know, get into a lot of the protocols or preliminaries, and, you know, get a meeting together and we need to, you know, discuss this thing. No, they were being about the Lord's business as they understood the relationship and the customs and mannerisms of those days. Okay, so verse 16 and 4, it talks about a special feature of the actions of faith. When the women realized that they had no answer to the question about the stone, right? They could have stopped and they could have turned around and said, well, okay, since we can't move the stone, we just leave it like that. We won't do it until we can figure that out. But no, they kept moving forward. They moved forward and they got it done. They got it done. So, you know, we got to ask ourselves the same question. Would we keep going? You know, would we keep going? They went to the tomb and they found that the stone was already moved, which is a lesson for us all, because believers often fail to do things, get things done, because they focus on the size of the stone and they focus on what they can't do versus what God can do. And they don't always see that that their fear is the sinking weight. The sinking weight, it brings about failure. It stops them in their tracks, and they never reach the tomb. They never even get to the place where they're going to perform services for the Lord. They never get to see what God has already done, what he's already done. And that's why we can praise God in advance. Even while we're on the way to deal with some of these issues, some of the trials and the battles that we have to face in life, if we praise him in advance and we're obedient to what he tells us to do, then when we get to the battle, we'll find that God has provided. One way or another, he has provided. Amen. And so God will give us the insight as what to do when we persist. But in verses 5 through 6, we meet the angel. Now, here's the thing about this. Because we have to think in a supernatural way. Our minds have to shift to the supernatural, because not everybody believe in angels, but surely this is not something in the material world that people can just easily accept. But we have to think about this. If we discount the existence and operation of angels, then we may discount a lot of things. We may not believe in the birth or the work of Christ. You know, we may not believe in the birth or the work of John the Baptist. And so, you know, if we don't at this point, when the angel comes on the scene in verse 5 and 6, and we don't believe in that, we may just close the Bible and just, you know, discount everything about it, because there's got to be a measure of belief in the supernatural or things that are beyond our comprehension. And, you know, and what we have, what we know, we have what we believe, and we have what we think we know, you know. But it's God lets us know what truth is. And Jesus said, I am the truth, the life, and the way. Okay, so still what we have in verse 6, the women were afraid. And so the human response to things that are out of our scope can be that of fear. They were deeply alarmed. It was a very emotional and dramatic period of time. And so you think about that. Some people try to say that these women had extraordinary faith, but really, you think about it, they was expecting a dead body. They was expecting a dead body. So their faith was enough to get them to tend to the body of Jesus Christ and to not worry about that question, answer that question. They were so focused on that. So we move on, and the story of the woman shows us the amazing things that we can experience. You know, we can experience. When we dare to move in faith, sometimes we wait for every I to be dotted, T to be crossed. But when we continue, we do get to a place where we discover what God has done. And so, you know, this is not to discount the women. I think it's very it's a very valuable experience to know of, in that they pressed their way despite having a question about the stone. And so what we do is we look at a situation where we ourselves have to, you know, really just think about the wonders of God displayed in our own lives as we, you know, kind of move forward and with our desires, verses like James 4 and Psalms 119 and 4, James 4 and 8 and Psalms 119 and 2, Jeremiah 29 and 13. We just, I'll have those come up. But let's just take a look at one of them here. Let's look at James in the New Testament. Let's look at James 4 and 8. 4 and 8. It basically says, draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. And so, excuse me, again, the one of the reasons why we don't see the wonders of God displayed in our lives as we desire may very well have something to do with that, because he says draw nigh to God and he will draw nigh to you. But if we don't draw nigh to God, then what? You know, that is the question there. Then what? Then what? And so we try to understand these scriptures right here. But we must be like the women and move in faith towards our stone and our stones or our barriers or our obstacles in life, right? And that's despite our human response of fear and trembling, right? Okay, so I want to try to bring this to a close with a couple of things. There's a story about a young man, 14, out of the African country of Malawi. His name is William, and I want to try to pronounce this right. Kam Kwamba, right? And basically, where he lived in that place, Malawi, it was one of the poorest countries in the world, with about 70% of the population living below poverty level, and it was scarce with water and food. But he wanted to do something about that. And so, you know, when we think about our service to God and women, their service to the Lord, there's also this thing where our faith extends to our community. And in the face of, again, stones, obstacles, things that we just try to think, how, who's going to do it? Who can do it? You know, we got these obstacles. Like William, his tombstone was no engineering background. He had no money, no materials to do the work. But he did have a deep concern, as with the women, a deep concern to get something done. And so against the odds, he got scraps of material, taught himself the fundamentals of making a windmill and basic electricity. And he set out to make something that would help the community. And in fact, he did that. He invented the windmill and the apparatus that brought water and electricity to the community. Okay. And so you think about that in Mark 15, like William in Malawi and the women, right? The key to success is to at least start and do not stop. Have faith in the Lord. Have faith. Have faith. And do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Have faith. Have faith. If you have faith at least the size of a mustard seed, then you can make some things happen. And so we move on to the case study, and the case study talks a little bit about the importance of the resurrection narrative to Christianity. The resurrection power that keeps Christians flying high and moving forward. If the resurrection did not take place, that would be like running out of fuel. Like we wouldn't have fuel in our planes to fly. We just crash. Paul said that we'd be most miserable if the resurrection had not taken place. And so we needed this. We needed this day. We really needed this day. So it's important to understand there will be challenges. There will be naysayers. There will be detractors. Detractors, people who are skeptics, and they will come up with all kinds of theories, the swoon theory, they will come up with theories about the alternative survival, things like that, like Jesus was resuscitated or he didn't die, he didn't really die, all of this. But when you think about certain things that took place, again, verifying that he had in fact died, and then some of the things that took place, the condition of his body, things like that. But we have questions that we have to consider, like, do we accept the Bible as the inspired word of God? You know, and so we think about the Bible as being the inspired word of God, then person who answers in the negative, you answer in the negative, no one can prove anything to you. No one can prove anything. In that person's mind, Jesus was not born. He's not the Son of God, and he's not the Savior of the world. So, you know, he could not have been crucified, and thus he could not have been resurrected. And so people who just don't believe, I mean, you're kicking against a brick wall. Because those people, they basically reject the whole entire book, amen, of the Bible. But another way to defend the belief in the resurrection is to accept that detractors do not believe it. Just accept it. Don't, you know, just accept the fact that they don't believe. It's on them. It's on them. To believe. It's on each individual to believe. But you can ask them, what do they believe about human life? What, because we can't avoid it. Human life is before us all, and death is before us all, and the possibility of afterlife. And so it's okay to ask that kind of question, ask those kind of questions. And then you find that many of them believe what Sigmund Freud and B.F. Skinner, the psychologists, believe, which was that humans are like animals. They're just like animals. They mere creatures of instinct. And so we look at that, but you know, the thing about it is, those animals don't need a savior. We need a savior. Whether dead or alive, we need a savior. And you think about the makeup of mankind. The Bible says that we were created in the image of God, male and female, created in his image. So we think about that. Okay. So in summary, we just want to keep in mind that it's crazy to argue with people who don't believe. It's crazy to you believe you can force an intellectual skeptic to accept the resurrection narrative. That would be perhaps foolish and more insane for us to do. The reality is such people have no quarrel with the resurrection story. Their basic objection is deeper than that. It has to do with fundamental confusion about humans, God, the Bible, and the human need for a savior. And so we think about that. You have to drive the opponents to the core position on human life and the existence of God and the relationship between the two. That's what you want to drive home to them. But we got to hold on to our belief. We got to hold on to our belief about God's love for us as it is expressed in the dying of Jesus upon the cross, him giving his life, shedding his precious blood for us, and in the resurrection, resurrected Savior. That narrative, we have to see God's love happening there. Okay. And then, so lastly, in terms of the life application, we have some questions. The women experienced the glorious work of God personally, they experienced that, that work of the Lord. But is there anything or something that, we are confident God has called us to do, but we don't have all the answers as to how to move forward. And so that's the question. That's the question. Is when we think about our lives now, is it possible that, like the ladies having work to do, that we don't have the answers to all the obstacles in our lives? The stones that need to be rolled away in our lives. And so you think about it. Ecclesiastes 11:4 talks about farmers who wait for perfect weather. They never plant. They wait for perfect weather. They can kind of get an idea from the weather, from what they see. But, you know, if they wait for it, because at the time, you know, there's got to be it's a process, you know. And so the solid lessons of the resurrection prompts two questions. The first is to what extent each person buys into the details of the resurrection of Christ, right? And then, second, can you share those beliefs in a reasonable, calm, but impressive tone? You know, think about what you truly believe, what you really take to heart about this man who died and was buried and rose again, right? Think about that. Think about if you had to give someone a reason or an answer for the hope that is within. Think about that right there. Would you be able to? Can we talk about that thing? You know, and this is why we discuss, have Bible studies. Have Bible studies. Don't be afraid, because a lot of people can't do that. A lot of people can't do that. But as Christians, we want to be able to trust our pastors, our leadership, our mature Christians to help us to be able to defend the resurrection, give a reason for the hope that is within us. Amen. Okay. And you could do like this one particular guy that's mentioned here. His name is Ronald. Let's see here. His first name is Ronald. Anyway, he's a student, and instead of wrestling with the opponents or the opposition, he just about him trying to prove it. He said, "You disprove it. You disprove it." And so that's where it went on. And if you try to understand the weakness of the argument, the weaknesses or the failings of the arguments that the opponents or opposition have, when you look at that, when you look at the lack of historical verification, the hallucination argument, the stolen body argument, when you look for weaknesses in these theories, the swoon theory and the legend theories, when you look for weaknesses in these theories, you become better equipped to defend the gospel. Okay? So you want to be familiar with these arguments that come up from time to time. Amen. But today is a day to celebrate and focus on the fact that we serve a risen Savior. And so there are a few questions in closing out. What is the most challenging thing to accept about the resurrection story? And why did no one, I'm talking about the three women and the disciples included, why did no one expect Jesus' resurrection? Even though he predicted it, they didn't expect it to take place. And then lastly, how different would the world be, you know, if Easter celebration was not surrounded or emerged in retail, you know, if the merchants, retailers did not use Easter week as a major sales opportunity, but rather for all of us to celebrate the risen Savior, to look at it squarely and celebrate that. So in closing, we're going to have a prayer, and we pray that you have been blessed by this. Amen. And so let's close out in prayer. Let us pray. Loving Creator, grant me the wisdom to understand the revealed mysteries of your almighty power and the faith to accept those things which are beyond my maturity. You are my God, Jesus, my Savior, and I rejoice that I can celebrate the resurrection of my Lord. This is my prayer of thanksgiving in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 God bless you. God bless you. And so we thank you for tuning in, and we pray that you continue to enjoy and celebrate this Resurrection Sunday. And just know that we love you. And if you're ever in the Springfield, Tennessee area, the information will be posted here. Feel free to come and worship with us. Amen. And so on behalf of... Pastor Sweat and the St. John AME Church and D Impact Ministries. We thank you and we give God all the praise and glory. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you.